So the latest Tesla Q2 earnings call was really interesting, and we will go into detail about the most important revelations and many exciting updates on the new Tesla Roadster, Cybertruck, and the Tesla Semi were shared. And not enough, there are rumors floating around about a possible Model S and X refresh or redesign.
Then we also want to talk about Tesla's nickel mining strategy, about Tesla suing Rivian, but of course also about what the inclusion in the S&P 500 index will mean for Tesla. And of course, as every week, we also have updates on air taxis, namely the first commercial air taxi flights are actually starting in China, and news from TUM Hyperloop. We actually soon might get a Hyperloop test track here in Munich. A lot to talk about as always, so stay tuned.
So of course, the biggest event lately was Tesla's Q2 earnings call, which surprised Wall Street by its sheer positiveness, sending the Tesla stock on another surge. Tesla reported a revenue of $6.036 billion, a GAAP operating income of $327 million, resulting in a $104 million net income. Therefore, Tesla has now achieved the fourth quarter of profitability in a row, which means the inclusion of Tesla in the S&P 500 is basically a done deal. Tesla's cash reserves now increased to $8.6 billion, which is enough for 7 to 8 new gigafactories, by the way. So yeah, it's looking excellent for Tesla. And an inclusion into the S&P 500 index, by the way, would most likely send the stock even higher, as lots of funds would then have to automatically buy Tesla stock, just because it would be listed on the S&P 500. And lots of additional interesting information was released on the earnings call as well. For example, Elon confirmed Giga Austin, about which we already talked last week in this video here. And he even gave a timeline for Cybertruck and Tesla Semi. Both Cybertruck and Tesla Semi will enter production there in late 2021. But the factory will also produce Model Ys and 3s for the East Coast.
The shift to iron phosphate batteries in China will free up a lot of capacity for the higher density nickel graphite lithium ion batteries, which Tesla is using outside of China, thus enabling them to build the Cybertruck and the Tesla Semi in large quantities. And we know that especially the Tesla Semi will need giant battery packs. Therefore, Tesla needs a lot of resources, especially nickel, which is by weight the main constituent of lithium-ion batteries, not lithium. Therefore, Tesla is already looking to secure as many nickel supply chains as possible. And Elon even called out to mining companies to start mining as much nickel as possible. Now, we strongly suspect that Elon is actually already heavily engaged in talks with some nickel mining companies to secure a lot of nickel for Tesla's own battery cells. And we know that Tesla wants to build their own batteries based on Silicon and Maxwell battery technology. We are sure they will reveal this on the battery day on the 22nd of September.
Then Tesla will probably show us a complete battery assembly line at their Fremont factory. This new battery will probably be the often talked of 1 million mile battery, and will probably have a 20 to 30% higher energy density than Panasonic's current 2170 cells. So probably around 300 to 350 watt hours per kilogram of energy density. This will allow for cars with 500 to 600 miles of range. And we know that the new Tesla Roadster will have exactly that, an incredible 600 miles of range. Elon even hinted at the Roadster's production timeline, indicating that the Roadster will be produced at the Fremont factory, so not at the new Giga Austin. And we think that the Tesla Semi will employ this new in-house produced Tesla battery as well. According to Elon, we can expect the Roadster to enter production at some point next year. Now, something else highly interesting surfaced last week that perfectly fits into that whole Tesla Roadrunner project. which is the name of Tesla's in-house built battery. And if you would like to stay up to date on electric cars, Tesla, boring tunnels, air taxis, and even SpaceX, and maybe even Boeing and SLS, please consider to subscribe to this channel. We would greatly appreciate it, and always bring you the most exciting news.
So Electrek released an article last week, which states that besides the Roadrunner project, Tesla is working on another project codenamed Palladium. We already speculated in this video here that the new Model S Plaid would probably use the same battery tech as the new Tesla Roadster and employ the same next generation in-house built battery. Now these rumors further solidify this hypothesis, but this goes even further. Because according to Electrek sources, linked to the article by the way in the description, the Model S and X could not only get a battery upgrade, but actually a complete redesign, both interior and exterior, which we would find really excellent by the way, since we often said that design-wise the Model S and X, but especially the Model S, starts to feel a bit outdated. An updated Model S and X design and an increased range of maybe around 500 miles and also increased charging speed would certainly very much boost the attractiveness of the Model S and X. Because currently the Model S and X sales keep declining and declining, since the Model Y and the Model 3 just offer better value for the money. So this could bring the Model S and X back in a big way.
Now why is this project called Palladium? Will it actually make use of the metal itself? Well, this is too speculative, so we will have to wait until with some luck we could learn more on Battery Day on September the 22nd. And besides the new Model S and X's, the new Tesla Roadster, the Tesla Semi, and of course the amazing Cybertruck, we shouldn't forget that Tesla is also working on a smaller entry-level car, which will be designed and produced in China. And probably even a Tesla van, which will most likely also be used in the boring company loop system. So there's really insanely much happening with Tesla, which further cements our belief that legacy car makers are just waiting for their inevitable doomsday. The funniest thing is actually that the dying car companies in large part helped Tesla to achieve profitability by paying Tesla a record $428 million in regulatory credits. First and foremost, Fiat Chrysler, but also GM. It's so funny that these car companies just accelerate their own demise by weakening themselves and by making Tesla even stronger.
In other news, Tesla sued Rivian and four former employees over allegedly stealing trade secrets after being hired by Rivian. Tesla also sued XPeng already earlier for similar reasons, accusing XPeng to have stolen their autopilot source code. But we can't understand Tesla, because if the claims are true, then stealing confidential information is really not cool, and Rivian even encouraging such actions would be quite disappointing. Now it's too early to tell what's really happening, but we guess we'll have to wait until the trial begins to find out more.
And now, of course, we have to examine the latest progress with electric air taxis. Because many people think that this is sci-fi stuff, and it's still decades away. But air taxis are really nearer than most people would think. Just last week, the first commercial air taxi trips started in China. Aerial sightseeing flights started in the city of Yantai in East China. The flights are conducted with an Ehang 216 two-seater aerial vehicle drone. Ehang's air taxi is powered by 16 propellers and offers a maximum range of 20 miles or a bit more than 30 kilometers at a top speed of 60 mph or 100 kph. And why does the city here look totally non-Chinese but weirdly late 19th early 20th century European? Well, because the city of Yantai once hosted many embassies from lots of European countries, which were already built over 100 years ago to make the ambassadors back then feel right at home. So yeah, flying air taxis are not a distant sci-fi dream, But this is really starting to happen right now. And you will be surprised how commonplace air taxi travel will be in only 10 years.
And what else will be quite common? Well, maybe not already in 10 years, but more likely 20 years? Hyperloop, of course. Hyperloop is the other big breakthrough transportation technology about which we talk so often on this channel. And even though many people still refuse to believe that it is technologically possible, because some guy made a video and said it's not possible, the same guy, by the way, also saying reusable rockets are not possible, you know, just saying, Hyperloop is in fact happening, whether naysayers like it or not. We already mentioned the TUM Hyperloop team from Munich, where we live. They currently hold the speed record of 463 kph or 288 mph from the last SpaceX Hyperloop competition. And now the TUM Hyperloop team is planning to build a full-scale Hyperloop test tube near Munich together with a real pod. Okay, the tube will be very short, only 21 meters long, so it is not intended as a real test track, but its purpose will be to test a human-sized passenger pod in near vacuum conditions within the tube. So TUM Hyperloop will also build a human-sized passenger pod. They plan on building this demonstrator project in 2021. And since it's really near to where we live, you can certainly expect some coverage of the tube and the pod, and maybe even get the team behind this project to tell us a bit more about the project and about their future plans. And if despite all our Hyperloop videos, you still don't believe that Hyperloop is possible, you can watch this video here.
So thanks for watching the JS Disruption Report, and I say, on to the future.
Perfect, look.
Even Hulk would appreciate it, and then you're like, yes!